Hi, everybody. Pastor Mark here with you for online worship at East Brady Baptist Church for the week of August 29th, 2021. Hey, I'm so glad that you could join us for worship online like this. Let's get started with our call to worship this week, which is adapted from Psalm 29. Sing to the Lord, O you saints of His. Praise His holy name. God has turned our mourning into dancing. O Lord, my God, I will give you thanks forever. Let us pray. Salvation-giving God, we know that you have broken the chains that bind us to the systems of sin and death. Yet we confess that we have often fallen back into old patterns. We follow old idols and avoid the freedom you graciously extend. Shatter our chains once again, Lord, so that we may walk boldly in your kingdom as we love and serve those around us. In the name of Jesus, amen. Well, for announcements today, just a reminder, if you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, go ahead and leave us a message in the comments. We'd love to hear from you, know that you're with us. And likewise, you can leave prayer requests in there. We'll be sure to see that and pray for each other as a church community. So you can just use the comments for that. Another thing is this Wednesday, believe it or not, September 1st already, at 6 p.m. at our church building at 508 Kelly's Way, we are having an ice cream social and a movie night that's starting at 6. So, hey, if you're unable to get out for Sunday morning for worship to join us, and so you join us online, but for whatever reason you can get out Wednesday, won't you consider joining us at 6 p.m. this Wednesday? Great ice cream and then a good movie to follow. That's this Wednesday at 6 p.m. Let us now turn to our teaching for the week and our scriptures. We are in the middle of an overview of the book of Romans. So today we look to Romans chapter 9. If you've got a Bible or an electronic device in which you use to read your Bible, won't you open it to Romans chapter 9? I'm going to start reading to you today at verse 14. And as usual here online, we'll also put the words of the scripture up on screen for you. At Romans 9, 14, it says, "What then shall we say? Is God unjust? Not at all. For he says to Moses, 'I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion.' It does not therefore depend on human desire or effort, but on God's mercy. The scripture says to Pharaoh, 'I raised you up for this very purpose, that I might display my power in you and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth.' Therefore, God has mercy on whom he wants to have mercy, and he hardens whom he wants to harden. One of you will say to me, 'Then why does God still blame us? For who's able to resist his will?' But who are you, a human being, to talk back to God? Shall what is formed say to the one who formed it, 'Why did you make me like this?' Does not the potter have the right to make out of the same lump of clay some pottery for special purposes and some for common use? What if God, although choosing to show his wrath and make his power known, bore with great patience the objects of his wrath, prepared for destruction? What if he did this to make the riches of his glory known to the objects of his mercy, whom he prepared in advance for glory?" May the Lord add his blessing to this reading and hearing of his holy word. Well, Warren Wiersbe once told a story about how once he was in Chicago passing out Bible tracts on one of the street corners, and this back in the day when people used to do this, and most of the people, he said, you know, they graciously accepted the tracts. Don't know if they ever went and read them, but they were just gracious and took it. But one man took the tract and with a snarl crumpled it up and threw it in the gutter. Now, the name of the tract was Four Things God Wants You to Know. And the man must have seen that title because he said, "There are a few things I would like God to know. Why is there so much sorrow and tragedy in this world? Why do the innocent suffer while the rich go free? Bah, don't tell me there is a God. If there is, then God is the biggest sinner who ever lived." And with that, the man turned away and disappeared into the crowd. That's kind of familiar, isn't it? I mean, maybe not specifically, but in general it is. Maybe you don't go around passing out Bible tracts on street corners, But you very well may have had a conversation at one time or another with someone who said or hinted at similar things. Maybe it was a conversation with an atheist who's just looking to put you in your place for your faith. Or maybe you had a conversation with someone to whom you're explaining the gospel and they're just struggling to come to faith, so they've said things like this. Or maybe you've even had this conversation with yourself. You've said these things to yourself from time to time. You've asked these questions. I mean, this conversation, it's very much related to the question of suffering in this world. You know, people ask, if God is so loving, how come he allows children to suffer in this world? Or if God is so great, how come he doesn't allow everyone into heaven? If God is a loving God, then how can he send anyone to hell? If God is love, then how come he saves me but condemns others to suffering for eternity in hell? If God is in control of everything, how can he blame us for our mistakes and rebellion? See, they're all kind of variations on that same line of questions, right? Maybe you've heard those questions. Maybe you yourself have asked those questions. And maybe when confronted with those questions, you've struggled to give an answer. Because they're difficult questions, right? I mean, it's a difficult question, although the answer is easy. Just this past weekend, last weekend, I was counseling somebody over Facebook Messenger on how to answer some questions like this that he was getting from somebody he was trying to witness to. And as I wrote then, I tell you now, this difficult question, it's actually a simple but long answer that we can give for them. I mean, the answer is simple because it's summed up by one statement in the Apostle Paul in today's scripture passage out of Romans chapter 9. You ready for it? Here it is. Here's the simple answer. Romans 9:20. Who are you, a human being, to talk back to God? See, that's the center of the whole answer. One sentence. It's simple. Don't you just want to say that to people sometimes, right? Who are you to talk back to God? Except rarely, if ever, does anyone respond well to you saying that. So it might be a relief. It might feel good for you to say it. But it really doesn't do anything to spread the kingdom of God. It just shuts the other person down. And that's why the simple answer kind of becomes a long answer, because then we have to kind of unpack what it means so that people aren't immediately put off by it and they can get a fuller idea of everything at play here. And that's actually what Paul does for us in Romans 9. He gives a simple answer, but then he talks about it quite a bit in our passage today. You see, earlier in chapter 9, how we get to where we got in verse 14, earlier in chapter 9, Paul has been writing about his grief over the Jews. The Jews, God's chosen people, Paul's people, they had, at least in Paul's time, rejected the grace of God that he had offered them in Christ Jesus. They had rejected Jesus. And in expressing his grief over this, Paul kind of gets into a discussion of how some will experience God's mercy. They'll come by faith in Jesus Christ. Others won't experience God's mercy, those who don't come by faith in Christ. And Paul kind of explains that this goes back all the way to Abraham, right, in the Old Testament. I mean, God called Abraham, promised Abraham. Abraham said, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to bless your descendants, and you're going to be a blessing to the whole earth. He made this promise, this blessing to Abraham. But not all of Abraham's descendants received that blessing or that promise going forward. The blessing was passed on to Abraham's son Isaac. But Ishmael, Abraham's other son, to a servant, did not receive the blessing, didn't inherit the promise. And even then, when the blessing is passed on through Isaac, Abraham's son, not all of Isaac's children received the blessing or the promise. The blessing is passed on through Isaac's son, Jacob, later renamed Israel. But Isaac's son, Esau, doesn't inherit the blessing and the promise. Some receive God's promise and some don't. And that's what brings Paul to write in Romans 9:14, the start of our passage today. What then shall we say? Is God unjust? Not at all. This idea that God favors some and not others. God delivers some and not others. Gives the promise to some and others. Isn't that unjust? Isn't that unfair? It's not fair. You see, you know, Paul kind of puts the conversation in terms like it's two little kids fighting over their favorite toy, right? I mean, you know how it goes in the other room and you're like, Mom, Dad, Uncle Mark, whoever you are, he's not sharing, she's not sharing. So what do you do? You go over to where the kids are, and you try to figure out who had this toy first, or who otherwise has the greater claim to this toy, the stupid toy they're going to forget about in like 40 seconds, right? Now, you know that because of their fighting and their selfishness, neither of them really deserves the toy. But you're going to sort it out, and you're going to give that toy to one of them. And then what does the other kid, the kid who doesn't get the toy, what does he say? What is he more like whine? That's not fair. It's not fair that they received a blessing and I didn't. You see, some will declare likewise regarding God showing favor to some and not others. It's not fair. It's not just for God to do that. Paul writes, sure it is. Sure it is. You see, some declare that God is wicked because he delivers some from suffering, while others in this world suffer immensely. Some would say it's not fair. It's not just that we Americans have more than we could ever need in this world, while other countries, third world countries, people are starving and they're suffering. It's not fair. Look, here's the thing. We're all sinners. Any suffering we might experience on this earth is just a hint of the suffering that is experienced in the next world for those who are in hell. And because we're all sinners, we all deserve that suffering. We all deserve hell. We have purchased that with our sins. It is just that we all suffer. Starting right now on this earth, we should all be suffering because we're all sinners. But God, in his mercy, he's been gracious to deliver some of us from suffering on this earth. So the question isn't, how can a loving God allow some in this world to suffer? The declaration is, how marvelous is God that he actually shows mercy to some so that they don't suffer as much as they otherwise would. See, because of our sin, we all deserve suffering. That's just. Praise God that he shows some of us mercy. Paul explains it further by writing in Romans 9:15, for he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. You see, Paul is actually quoting here from Exodus chapter 33. So let's check out what he's referring to. Exodus chapter 33 finds Moses coming down off the mountain after meeting with God. See, it's during this meeting with God that God has given Moses more details about his law. God was explaining to Moses how the people of Israel were waiting below, at the mountain bottom below, how they are to live as God's righteous people. And as God is explaining how the people are to live to righteous for him, well, they're doing something. Moses comes down the mountain and he finds the people engaged in idolatrous revelry. I mean, in Moses' absence, Moses' brother Aaron, he's taken gold and he's fashioned a calf out of this gold and he's given it to the people as their idol. He says, here's your God. And so the people take the worshiping this stupid gold statue and they set to all sorts of licentious activity that would be associated with the religious practices of the false religions of the people around them. It's wicked, dirty stuff. I mean, it's like Studio 54, those of you who remember that, right? It's like Studio 54 all throughout the camp. So Moses, he finds a small number of people, says, who's for the Lord? And a small number of people will say, all right, we're coming out of this revel. We're for the Lord. And so Moses gets him. He says, you all, you take swords and you go just through the camp swinging, killing anyone who gets anywhere, killing anyone who's too involved in their idolatrous revelry to see that you're coming and they're too involved to get out of the way. And in this way, Moses gets the people's attention. He interrupts their sinful revelry and he puts a stop to it. And in doing so, we are told that 3,000 people of the Israelites are killed that day in the name of God. And so then we find later in the chapter, God comes and he passes before Moses. And God tells Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy. And I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. And we, as fallen humans, right, we reread this and we think, mercy? Compassion? There's nothing merciful or compassionate about what's been going on here. See, when we think and say things like that, you know, that's kind of an indication that we just don't understand God's mercy and his compassion. It's an indication that our finite human minds, we don't think as deeply about the things as God does. Maybe we can't. Because all the people of Israel are guilty. They're all guilty. Moses found the entire camp engaged in worshiping that idol and doing whatever else it was they were doing. The just thing is that they should all be punished because they're all guilty. But God, in his love, in his patience, decides to show mercy and compassion so that only 3,000 are killed. 3,000 out of probably about 1 million people. It's a small number. You see, they all deserved it. But only a very small number were punished. That's mercy. That's compassion. Listen, you don't ever want God to bring into your presence the full weight of his justice without it being tempered by his mercy and his compassion. Because you too are a sinner. You are guilty of rebelling against God in your own way, just as the Israelites rebelled. So you also cannot stand under God's justice. You need his justice to be tempered with his mercy and his compassion. It is in that mercy and compassion that God provides for you a Savior, his Son, Jesus Christ, for justice's sake. Punishment had to be meted, right, for justice to be done. So for justice's sake, God punished Christ on the cross for you. And so now, in his mercy and in his compassion, he gives you Christ. He now accepts you as righteous when you follow and believe in his Son. That's who God decides to show mercy and compassion to, those who follow Jesus. God says, I will show mercy to whom I will show mercy, and I will show compassion to whom I will show compassion. He says, I will do it my way, in a way you would never think of. God's just so amazing how he does this. And he says, my way is through my Son, Jesus Christ. See, we are all guilty and deserving of punishment, suffering. Suffering that begins right now on this earth because of our sin. So the question isn't, why does God allow some to suffer? The question is, why does God actually save us from some of the suffering? Why does he save and deliver some of us? And the answer is because he is merciful and he is compassionate. This idea that some are saved from the suffering on this earth, even some who are not eternally saved, but yet they're still saved from suffering on this earth, it's what Paul is getting at in verses 22 and 23, mostly verse 22. In Romans 9:22, Paul writes, what if God, although choosing to show his wrath and make his power known, bore with great patience the objects of his wrath, prepared for destruction? Now, Paul here is talking about those who are prepared for destruction. And some people, they read that and they just assume that means God himself prepared the people for destruction, meaning that God must have just created these people just so he could send them to hell. And they say, well, how's that fair? How's that just? How's that love? Because that's not actually what the passage is saying here. It's not God who prepared the people for destruction. It's the people themselves who have prepared themselves for destruction. They bring destruction on themselves by hardening their hearts against God, the same way Pharaoh hardened his heart against God in the book of Exodus. And that's why Paul kind of references that a little bit earlier in Romans 9. They prepare themselves for destruction by denying Christ and rejecting God's compassionate and merciful provision for their salvation. They are prepared for destruction. And so Paul does refer to them here as objects of God's wrath, because in eternity, apart from Christ, they will experience God's wrath. They will experience the eternal separation from God. But in the meantime, God in his mercy, God in his compassion bears with them, Paul writes, with great patience. Even though they're destined for destruction by their own choice, this means that during their time on this earth, God is patient to allow some of them to have, well, pretty good existence. He's patient in order and keeps them from fully suffering as much as they might otherwise suffer. He saves them from suffering here and now, all because of God's mercy and compassion. Again, they have hardened their hearts against God. They deserve suffering and punishment according to their own sin. But God is patient with them and he protects them while they are on this earth. It's kind of like a flower garden that runs along the side of my parents' place, right? Every spring, I go and I clear out all the debris, all the dead leaves, everything that's just kind of gathered there over winter. I clear it all out, and I weed it, get all the weeds pulled out, and I fertilize it, and then I go get the new flower plants, and I plant them in there, take my time to do that, get them looking all nice. And then throughout the season, the whole summer, I water regularly, right? And I go and I pull out any weeds that might start growing up in between those flowers. So I patiently work hard to keep it looking really nice all summer. Now I know that come fall, those flowers are going to turn brown and die anyway, right? Yet for my own satisfaction, I cultivate that garden in the meantime. It's the same way with God. Some have prepared themselves for destruction. They have hardened their hearts against God. They have rejected God's provision for salvation. Even so, while they are on this earth, God is patient with them, and he delivers them from some of the suffering that would otherwise await them. Think of it this way. For those who have not hardened their hearts against God, for those who have trusted in the merciful, compassionate provision of Jesus Christ, what suffering they experience on this earth is the worst it's ever going to get. If you follow Jesus, whatever you're going through now, it might be horrible, it's the worst it's ever going to get for you in eternity. For those who have hardened their hearts against God and his mercy and compassion, well, whatever they experience on this earth, even if it's suffering on this earth, that's the best it's ever going to be for them. God will show mercy and compassion on whom he chooses. And he chooses to show mercy and compassion on those who come to him through his son, Jesus Christ. In Romans 9:16, Paul tells us that this doesn't depend on man's desire or effort. It doesn't depend on what we think is right or on what we do or what we think we should be doing. No, but it's all God. It all depends on God's mercy. God in his mercy saves some. He saves all who come to him through Christ Jesus. What this all comes back to is what Paul starts writing about in chapter 9, verses 19 through 21. Look, in verse 19, Paul writes, "One of you will say to me, then why does God still blame us for who resists his will? Why does God still blame us for our sins? If God chooses to forgive some and not others, if he chooses not to show some mercy and compassion, isn't that God's fault?" No. And that's the simple answer. No, it's not God's fault. It's your fault. Because it's your sin. In verse 20, Paul writes, "Who are you, a human being, to talk back to God?" Who are you to talk back to God? Who are you to decide that God's mercy and compassion, his plan for salvation, it's not good enough? You're a mere human being. You don't know enough to question God on how and why he does what he does. Your mind's too limited. You can never know enough. That's the lesson of the book of Job. We don't have time to go into it, but the book of Job in the Old Testament is just 42 chapters of Job learning this lesson. How arrogant it is that we, in our limited human capacity, think that we can question God, the all-knowing, almighty creator of all things, who holds all things together. Paul says that that's kind of like clay questioning a potter. It's kind of a silly example, but that's it. It says the potter takes the clay and he works it and he shapes it and he forms it into whatever he desires. Maybe the potter makes that clay into just an ordinary, everyday bowl used for holding water at the door so people could come in and wash their hands and maybe wash their feet. And so it's like not a very noble purpose for that particular piece of clay, right? But maybe he takes the clay and he makes it into this beautiful, ornate, detailed vase destined to sit next to the king's throne. The potter knows what its purpose will be, and he forms that clay to fit that purpose. How foolish it is to think that that finished pot then would come back to the potter and accuse him. "Why'd you make me like this? You don't know what you're doing. You're stupid. I know better." See, that's us. when we as humans question God about his mercy and his compassion and his grace. Who are we to talk back to God? You know, sometimes when I'm discussing such things with others and they're throwing all these questions at me and demanding answers from God, God, why don't you do it this way, the way I say it, you should do it, the way I see it should be. I just want to stop them and say to them, and just who are you? Who are you to demand such things from your Creator? Who do you think you are? Do you think you can even understand the answer if he would give it to you? And sometimes I do lovingly bring up such objections to people, and sometimes that causes some to consider, at least for a moment. Others, unfortunately, they have hardened their hearts against God so deeply that they can't see that question as anything other than a trick, just something to get them off track from the questions they are demanding need to be answered. But it's not a trick. It's a legitimate question. Who are you to question whether God's merciful and compassionate provision is good enough? Remember, none of us deserves God's mercy and compassion. Mercy and compassion are extended according to God's will, not our own. All of us deserves condemnation, not mercy. It is therefore a marvelous thing that God saves some. He shows compassion and mercy on some. Sadly, many continue to ask these questions of God simply because they do not desire to come into eternal life God's way. They want it their own way, which pretty much means they want to live however they want to do however they want, and then they want it to be rewarded for it all at the end. That's not how God does it. And God is not unjust. He's not mean. He's not wicked because he lets those who have prepared themselves for destruction go that way. He just lets them go where they're going. He is loving and merciful because he provides an avenue back to himself. He is compassionate because he has made provision for grace through his son, Jesus Christ. He's given them a way. This offer of grace through faith in Jesus, it's there for everyone. You know, people say, oh, well, how could God be so wicked to send something to hell? He offers grace to everyone. He's there trying to give it to you. Why are you objecting to God when he's trying to give you grace? Everyone who comes by faith will receive God's mercy and his provision. He chooses to receive them. If only they humble themselves, and that's the thing. You've got to humble yourself and come before God through Jesus Christ. And that's the main issue is so many people just do not want to humble themselves before the Almighty Creator. They want to be gods themselves. See, if you have come to God through Christ, then praise God today that he has been so merciful, he has been so compassionate to save you, though you don't deserve it. Praise God. And then watch out for your own thoughts, your own attitudes, because even though you've accepted God's provision of grace in Christ Jesus, sometimes we too, can get arrogant and start demanding answers from God. But who are you? Who am I? Who are we to talk back to God and question God? Don't let your confidence in the righteousness of Christ, a righteousness you yourself did nothing to earn, don't let that lead you down the path of arrogance. If you continue to stand at odds with God today, if you have not come to him through Jesus Christ, his merciful and compassionate provision, if you continue to stand there with your hard heart against God, won't you come today? Won't you humble yourself today? You don't have to keep asking, why does God blame me? Because you can be forgiven, you can be saved, you can be delivered. God offers salvation to all. He says, I will have compassion and mercy on whom I choose. I choose you when you come through Christ. Won't you come today? Let us pray. Dear God, our Heavenly Father, we come to you today addressing some difficult questions. Maybe for those who are watching, most of us watching, maybe they're not difficult questions because we have submitted ourselves to you and we acknowledge you and who you are. And so these aren't as difficult for us as they are for some, but maybe there's some out there who are just struggling with these questions, God. First of all, I ask that you help them. You bring them to a place where they can humble themselves before you, where they're not coming at you arrogantly asking these questions, But God, they're coming by asking these questions of a place of desiring to have a deeper faith. And God, won't you fill them with knowledge, with wisdom by your Holy Spirit to understand that it is only mercy and compassion that some people are saved, that some are shown grace, that some are loved, God. To open our eyes, all of our eyes, to the fact that we all deserve suffering so that we can be just so thankful that you show us grace by delivering us, sometimes physically in this world, in the here and now, but ultimately, God, in eternity in heaven. And God, those of us who acknowledge and understand your grace and mercy, oh, won't you continue to keep our hearts softened so that we don't become arrogant because of the righteousness your Son gave us, as we don't start questioning you into different things in life and demanding answers from you. Help us all to remember, who am I to question God? And let us lift you up to your proper place and put us low in our proper place. We pray in name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. That brings us to the end of another online worship service. So glad that you could join us. Hey, I understand you're watching online, but if you are in the area and you're able to get out and about, won't you consider joining us for in-person worship every Sunday at 10:30 a.m. at our church building at 508 Kelly's Way in East Brady. That's the main drag there, right next to Allegheny Water Sports here. Won't you consider joining us 10:30 on Sunday? In a moment, we're going to sing to close our hymn, which is I Sing the Mighty Power of God. But first, receive the blessing. May the grace of Christ our Savior, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you today and always. Amen.